straight up. Just go out to LA. LA. The new anthem. California Love Part 2.
One time.
To live in time, LA.
West side. West side. West side.
To live and die in L.A., where everybody try to fatten their pocket. So many hustle for the cash, so it's hard to knock it. Everybody got their own thing, currency chasing. Worldwide through the hard times, worrying faces. Shed tears as we bury brothers.
Well, hello, hello, hello. God bless you, community family, and welcome to Gang Talk with Skip Towns and Sister Heron. If you're listening, you can see we're in studio again, and we have special guests as we try to bring, we work to bring to you every week to talk about this very important issue. So, because sometimes Skip and I talk too much, I'm going to be quiet. Let's just jump into the show. So, Skip, I want to thank you, as you thank God for your recovery, for bringing you back, and for being our co-host.
Well, you just did it for me, so I'll make it short and brief. I always give honor and praise to God. Grateful to be here, grateful to be alive, grateful to be consistent with working, with helping people and educating people and also getting education myself. So thank you, sister, for having me as the co-host.
Well, thank you. See, because you're not only getting an education, you're sharing it.
Yes.
You're sharing it with the young folks that need to see their way out of this madness, and who better to help guide them than somebody that's been through the darkness and survived it.
Yes, ma'am.
Come out on the other side, back in your right mind.
The other side.
Okay, that stole you when it took you away.
Took me away.
Yes, it did. So,
man.
Well, we're happy that God has brought you back, given you back to us. And as our usual procedure, we always like to thank our guests from last week.
Yes. So I normally have a brain freeze right here because I'm getting senior moments, but I could never forget that was the illustrious, most incredible man that I know at 86 or 87 years old. And he said, I don't have to walk him down the alley.
No.
He said, I'm all right, and I'm parked right there. He jumped in his car, and he drove off, and
yes.
He has all his faculties and senses, and I'm just truly grateful and honored to be a part of the education process every time he talks, and that's Dr. Cecil Murray, Chip Murray. So
right.
Just grateful.
That's right. Me too. And it is such a blessing to hear from him, and a man of quality and
yes.
character that he has, and the history,
yes.
the history that he has. And again, we have to apologize because it was a miscommunication that we didn't reach John Mack in time to have him sitting here with us. But just to remind folks, Mr. Mack, and we have given him an honorary doctorate from Gang Talk. Well, Dr. Mack had to say goodbye to his beautiful wife, Harriet, that he's been married to since 1958.
Right.
And that's a lifetime that a lot of young people in my level, in my arena, will never see.
Right.
And that's a great loss for him. And so we just offer our condolences and our understanding and just praying for him to be well.
Yes, indeed.
Yes. So truly we thank
grateful.
Dr. Murray for
yes,
making
indeed.
Himself available to us. You know, because what I've noticed, Skip, and all the time that we've been doing this, some people won't come to this show.
Right. And it's okay. Bless their heart.
Yeah.
I just look at them and smile. Bless your heart.
Yeah, bless your heart.
Right.
And you can see we have the Unafraid tonight. And the joke before we get started was that I was at ceasefire meeting last night, and there were two young men in law enforcement, not LAPD, but they've never been to a meeting before. And one of their little smart alecky comments about what we were doing in that crowd was that, well, I look around here and I see most of you are over 35. It's like, well, yeah, I'm over 35 for sure. Mm-hmm. But he was implying that he really had anticipated seeing more young folks in that right. crowd.
Bless his heart. Do you know he's from High Patrol, right? Was that who it was? And
yes.
I invited them, and he met me. I'm 53 years old,
uh-huh.
and I invited them to come to ceasefire.
Mm-hmm.
And he should have brought the young lady with him.
He did bring a young lady.
Right. So who just graduated, got her master's from USC.
Okay.
And he shouldn't have expected that. But see, there's an expectation for the community to reach the people that they can't reach.
Right.
So when I told them that there's a group that's meeting, talking about these things, in his mind, I guess he thought they were 24, 25-year-olds, so that he can talk to them.
Mm-hmm.
So when he got to people who are his age.
Right.
And he's thinking like, well, I didn't want this.
Yeah.
Well, then, but you didn't create this either.
No.
You did not create this circle. You did not create the opportunity to talk to young people, and they won't talk to you. Did they wear their uniforms?
No.
Okay. Well, I told them, don't wear your uniform so you can really get a gist of the meeting or whatever.
Right.
So.
That's well, great. If they had come into a room with the young folks, as you suggest they were looking for, and they came in uniform, they'd have come to an empty room.
Right, right.
See, and the thoughtlessness with that is what makes you think the young people want to talk to you.
Right.
That's an assumption that's totally inaccurate. And we didn't jam them up. We just laughed at the 35-year-old crack. It's like, oh, yeah, okay. Well, somebody has to lead, and usually it's the older folks, so there it is. But it was a nice meeting, and we were talking basically about what brought us into this work. So it was good dialogue, but here again, as I expressed, I'm still looking for that youth forum. And until I can get somebody to get serious about making a platform for them, we're going to keep talking to the ones that come here.
Yes, ma'am.
So let's just get on with the show, Skip.
All right.
Well, you're introducing tonight.
Well, you know what? I would love to introduce, but let me let them introduce themselves. I'm going to start with the older of the young people. And if you just do an introduction, and remember, they're watching you because they want to know how to introduce themselves.
Right. Well, hello, everybody and family. My name is Kawisi Neblett. I hail from the state of Kentucky, born and raised. My association is I work with and I work I am actually under the tutelage of Skip Townsend when a lot of things when it comes to LA, because I definitely want to stay involved. I definitely want to be an asset to the community, but and not actually be a hindrance or just be a silent voice. So that's who I am. I'm a graduate of Kentucky State University. HBCU. I have a degree in business management, and right now I'm working on trying to find my way into developing something my own lane. I can't duplicate everybody, but I can definitely find my own lane and contribute to everybody else's efforts.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I'm Cody Townsend, and I am in fourth grade. I'm a little boy. As you can see.
Who's your daddy?
Oh, and my dad is Skip Townsend. And I really, 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 really like football. I want to go to college football and NFL. And I almost every day when I go to Andy's, well, it's called Beyond the Bell, I play football. And I wait until somebody picks me up. And if nobody's going to play football with me, I throw the ball, like, somewhere else and then chase it and see if I could beat it where it's going.
And you do your homework, too?
Yes, I do my homework.
All right.
Most of the time.
Hello, my name is Carter Townsend, and I am in fifth grade. And I play basketball. I go to the YMCA on Crenshaw. And I want to become an NBA superstar. And I practice every day. And I guess that's it.
How old are you?
I am 10 years old.
And who's your daddy?
My dad is Skip Townsend.
All right.
All right. So one of the things that I started doing when they were like 3 and 4 years old is I put some triangles on the wall, and I wanted them to understand the difference in the angles and understand a triangle so I can start them with math and trigonometry, geometry, start them learning about hex and rectangles, because I really wanted them to be advanced. Mm-hmm. And in school, and I didn't want math to be an issue.
Right.
So I just asked them on the way over here if they knew who invented algebra, and they weren't aware of it. So I know that they want football and basketball, and he runs track now, but I want them to be educated. And as this is Black History Month, there were some incredible things that this one said in the car. And I didn't, as I would have done my older kids, I would have and roared on them for saying something like that. And I don't want to roar on them. I really want to educate them that Black people in Kemet created chemistry. And that land is now called Egypt. And that Black people, there was something. Can you tell me what you said when you said that the Black people moved from Africa? And we asked why. Can you tell us why that the Europeans went to Africa to get slaves? Tell me what you said in the car.
I said because they were not smart.
Because the Black people were not smart. And the white people were smart?
Yes.
Right. So with that being said, I want them to understand that Black people were kings and queens. They created algebra. One of the hardest things for me to do right now is figure out what X is equal to. Mm-hmm. You know, and do I start with the parentheses or the numbers outside the parentheses? Do I go right to left or left to right? That is the hardest thing for me. And to tell me that Black people were not smart, and this is the measurement that they used for numbers.
Right.
Was incredible to build the pyramids.
Yes.
They've never heard of the pyramids. So I think it's a beautiful thing to have the young people. And, you know, I can't be mad at them. This is what they get from school.
Yes. It's called alternate facts.
Right. Alternate facts. That's it. All facts. Yes.
Right.
That's a new word for lie.
Okay, I'm going to end with this real quick. Cody, who discovered America?
The Black people.
What did the school teach you?
They taught me about Black History Month.
Who discovered America, Carter?
White people.
What is their name? Do you know their names? Tell me, who was Christopher Columbus? Who is that?
He is the man who created the United States of America.
Who is Christopher Columbus?
I truly don't know.
All right.
Doesn't know. And that, you know what, that's fair and that's honest. Because, Carter, how old are you?
I'm 10.
And Cody?
I'm 9.
9, okay.
Cody, grab here.
And these are our young children. And as you can hear from what Carter was just telling you, they're getting misinformation in their own classrooms.
Right.
And this falls into the conversation we had last week about controlling the education of our kids. And this is why, in that they have excluded the truth from Carter's teaching.
Right.
They've excluded it and misrepresented it to a young child of color that can't live in somebody else's lie.
Right.
That's a problem we have as a people in this country. We've been forced to live somebody else's lie. Forget our history. Like you said, commit Africans and in those ages developed algebra. Right. They had the biggest library in Alexandria before a Nero burned it down.
Right.
You see, so we were advanced in that to this day, that white man you talk about, he still doesn't know how they built those pyramids.
Right.
He still does not know. And so the beauty about being your dad's kids, he not only wants you to grow up with the best, but he wants you to know and be aware. And that's the way parents invest in their kids.
Mm. Right. So think of this, sister. Think of if I came into your house and I suppressed you and your family and your people and I made you guys live outside in the backyard and you work for me. And this is your house.
Yeah.
And I'm treating you bad. And at some point I said, you know what? It's okay if your kids learn. So now I want your children to learn from my children.
Mm-hmm.
Right. What do you think they're going to learn?
Exactly.
What do you think they're going to learn?
Exactly. His story.
Right.
His story. And, you know, we have talked about this quite a bit And the truth is, assimilation has caused this. When we were separate, trying to be equal, we had our own instructors, and I really meant to acknowledge Mary McLeod Bethune.
Right.
Okay, because I don't know if the babies know it or not. It used to be illegal for you guys to go to school. Did you know that? Yeah. It used to be a crime for black folks to be educated. Mm-hmm. Did you know that, Cody?
Yes.
Okay.
You guys, I think he thinks he's on a game show.
I think, and it's all right. Look, he's 9'10". They're great. Look at their precious faces. And they're our future. So it's right. All right for him to be on TV right. And know what that looks like. So right. if the news ever comes and sticks mm-hmm. that mic in your face, you'll say something intelligent. Right. Yeah, because you've had the practice here.
I remember just thinking about it. What James Baldwin said when you said assimilation, mm-hmm. James Baldwin said racial progress in America is how fast I assimilate to being white.
Wow.
Yes. My God.
Wow.
It has nothing to do with you respecting me, I respect you.
Yeah.
You be yourself and I be myself is how fast you can become me.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Not you being proud of being black. And so that also ties into the education. Like you were saying, Kemet and Kush was two different places in Africa, which pretty much considered the same place, was the first universities.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Plato, Socrates, Aristotle, all those were white philosophers.
Right.
But they all had one thing in common. They had to go to Africa to get their education.
Right. Did you know that, Carter?
No.
The first university was in Africa. It actually was not even in the first education was not even in Egypt. Mm-hmm. Egypt wasn't the first civilization in Africa. Egypt was just the most advanced one because they came after all the understanding.
Mm.
Right.
The first civilization always is the one who has to be the trailblazer.
Right, the pioneers.
They had to figure things out. That's when they had to look at the stars and had to map the stars out to travel at nighttime. They started out with. Then they also had to figure out the chemistry of different things. They had to say, okay, if I mix this with that, or I do this and that, then I'm going to get this result.
Right.
So they was the pioneers. The ones who got the credit was the Egyptians. Why? Because the Egyptians was close to the Mediterranean Sea. The Mediterranean Sea was connected to Persia. It had the three connections to Spain and Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. So they had that trifecta of all the different cultures coming through with trade. But if you think about it in the history books, even in when you're dealing with Africa, Africa considers Egypt the South because everybody migrated to Africa, up to Egypt. That's why in Egypt, North Egypt is considered South Egypt. Is the South and the North is and the South is considered the North, and people don't know that they have them backwards mm-hmm. because they all consider their roots is coming from the inland instead of coming from just where they're from.
Right.
Now, when you talk about the educational system, it didn't start off in Egypt. It started over in Ethiopia and also started over there in Nigeria area because Nigeria had one of the biggest libraries predates right. almost other libraries in the world.
Stop 1 second. Because you're in college right now. Mm-hmm. With everything you're saying is in college, I want them to understand at 9 and 10 years old, I want to hear what you just heard. Tell me what you just heard. Don't tell me what he said. Tell me what you heard.
I didn't understand.
Right. Okay. And I need them to, hold on, tell me what you heard.
That people were... thinking something else and they don't know what the truth is.
Right. See how it gets misconstrued. Right.
In layman terms is, you as an African American, the predated you was African. The people in Africa educated everybody else.
Stop right there. So going back, black people were the educated people. Black people were the scholars, the teachers. Mm-hmm. So there are people who are greatly known in history, Socrates, Aristotle, Plato, all these other people who are looked at as being brilliant people. Do you know where they got their brilliance? from black people. They went to black colleges. They went to areas where there was nothing but blacks who were educated. They were the pioneers he talked about. A pioneer is somebody who doesn't have a path before them. They have to create that path. They have to find out the chemistry. As he said, so let me ask you, what would happen if I put water and oil together? Do you know? Someone did it years ago and find out that water and oil don't mix. What would happen if I put milk and water together? What would happen? Which one would take control?
Milk.
No, you like milk, but the water would break the milk down. You said no?
No.
Okay.
The milk is white, right? White, right?
Right.
So if you put water on the table or in a cup, and then, but don't fill it up, just put a half, and then put milk in there, the milk would turn the water into white.
Okay, so not will it turn it white, but which one would have the heavier influence? Which one would be more influential in a cup? Say it's an 8-ounce glass.
I was just thinking that if because the color, like if I put,
what?
It was a dude at my grandmother's house, and we was doing colors, like see which one is stronger. Like we put red first, then blue, red state like that, and blue was like gone, like out the door, and then we put green in there, and then we put every single color, and no color can take over dark green.
Okay. Well, that's good. That's good. But let me tell you, share with you something else. No color can dominate black.
No.
Black is the presence of black, all colors.
Black, it takes black to make any one of those colors. Do you get that? So let me get out the colors and let me give you people. There is no way that, you know, and I don't mean to call people disrespectful terms. I'm saying white for understanding, the Caucasian people. So I'm not trying to be disrespectful to white people. But white people cannot create black people.
No.
White people cannot create Asian people. White people cannot create indigenous people. Indigenous people are what they now call Indians here in America. They're not Indians. Someone called them an Indian because they believed they were from the land of India.
That's because they were lost.
Because they were lost. They Christopher Columbus, who discovered America, who created the United States, he did not. He was lost.
He was lost.
He was not even a good navigator.
He can't discover something that's out of the people there.
Right. But yeah. I say that to you to say that the only group of people that can create other people are black people.
About Christopher Columbus, you said about the pyramids. Like, I know they didn't have that back then, but like when you get like toys from McDonald's, it shows you instructions. Like to make it, instructions.
To make the pyramid.
Piece of paper.
That's on McDonald's.
Yes. No. On the toys. No, not a pyramid to make toys. But like they have instructions, like you do the, like a part of a toy is already made on there. And then they put you, like they tell you, like put it in that space, like put that dot in that space.
They give you instructions on how to build it.
And then, like, you move to the next page or look at the bottom. It says step two.
Mm-hmm. It's the same thing with a vacuum cleaner.
Right.
It's the same thing with a entertainment center or something like that.
The only difference is there were no instructions to build the pyramid.
And no
like
McDonald's.
Your dad said, they had to figure it out. They had to figure it out. But this adds to the genius of that thought process that even can conceptualize a thing like a pyramid.
I want to say conceptualize. Can you tell him what that
means? Oh, I'm sorry.
Y'all forget 9 and 10 now.
I'm sorry. That's my mom. She made me read the dictionary. Dadgummit, right. I had to know more words. And conceptualize means that they thought it up. They created it.
So
they came up with it in his
there's
mind.
A thought in
they
your head.
They thought about it and then
before
they
you speak.
Made it happen.
That's conceptualized when I'm thinking about it up in here. Here's this part right here.
Here's a good way to bring genius into their heads, because I just thought about something. Who invented the washer and dryer?
They don't know. Sears.
you see
him? Roebuck.
No. Not it's not necessarily an individual, But what group of people invented washer and dryers?
I don't even think that's true.
What? Invention of washer and dryers?
Yes.
So how did washer and dryers get, how do you have a washer and dryer if it's not, who, if no one invented it? Invented it means someone who created it and made it. What group of people made a washer and dryer?
I thought there was just regular dryers, like different kinds of dryers, like with names.
They are. They have names to it, but no different than your glasses. Someone had to start off to make those glasses. But the person who, the group of people who invented washer and dryer was African Americans. The people who invented your ironing board, African American.
Okay, so I'm not sure if you understand. So listen real quick. He's not saying a washer and dryer together in one machine. They could be connected or separate, but a washer and a dryer. Because I heard you saying, it's regular. So a washer is a washing machine. Who created the washing machine? And then at some point, who created the dryer? So that you could separate, because I want you to conceptualize. I want you to see this in your mind, that there is a washer. You're at Matu's house. You're at your grandmother's house. There's a washer and there's a dryer. Who created that? Whose idea? Who was sitting around and said, you know what? I don't feel like going to the pond and washing my clothes. Mm-hmm. Someone said, man, I don't want to go to this running water that's coming down the stream or use this washboard. Mm-hmm. Or I don't want to go and pull the water up out the well. I want to be able to wash my clothes. Who thought of that? Oh, wow.
Someone black. Who thought of the cell phone?
Yes.
The cell phone was a black man.
So I want to talk to somebody. I'm in the car and I'm driving, or I'm on the bus.
Yeah. If you walk on a sidewalk, you know how when you walk on a sidewalk, you have the sidewalk, and then it's lowered for the street? You know the curve?
Oh, yes.
When you're walking. By the street. Yeah, when you walk on a sidewalk, there's a curve. That means that it's a drop-off, and you have the road that you can drive on. So it's separated. Africans started that. When they built their own cities in Africa, they had raised sidewalks because they knew that when the water would run down the street, they wouldn't have a flood and they can walk on it. When you go to the bathroom and you use the toilet, that's African invention.
When I was at the light, it was a field trip and I was at a movie theater. I was watching Queen of Katwa.
Yes.
And I saw that they had it was a storm coming. They knew. And their mom knew there was a storm coming, and she played chess, and she was famous already, but she was just a little kid. But when the flood came, the big daughter left the little son, and there was like a big flood like to her chest, and then the baby was smart. He grabbed onto his the thing that he was sitting on because the water pulled him away, and he grabbed onto the string, and his mom hooked it up so he could stay like that. Mm-hmm. But the water like went overboard, and he was holding onto the thing, calling for his sister because his sister left him. But he was smart enough to hold on to the string that connected to what he was sitting on.
Okay.
Well, you know, that story means that your dad is trying to prepare you.
Right.
He's trying to prepare you to think like that baby that knew enough from what he was taught to hold on. His sister left him, but he didn't lose his mind. He still understood, if I'm going to survive this, I better hold on to something.
Speaking of hold on, sister, I need y'all to hold on for 1 second because Stevie Wonder is going to sing about setting us free.
Yep.
So sing y'all hold on. Hold on like a hubcap in a fast lane.
And I'm free to be in your get them, you'll always be able to do it. God bless you, community family. And welcome back to Gang Talk. We were having such a great conversation with these young folks, these young men here that we're so happy to have with us, the two little youngest Townsend sons, and that's Cody and Carter. And it's just such a joy.
Which one is Cody and which one is Carter?
So
sister.
Raise your hand, Cody.
No, I'm too late. I'll try and see if you remember.
Well, because you know I'm forgetful, and you shouldn't put me on Front Street like that, Skip. Look.
That's a good one.
But look, truthfully, Carter has grown so much since I saw him the last time I didn't recognize him. But I told you that, didn't I? Don't nod your head.
Speak. Yes.
Yes. And what did I tell you during the break?
You told me that I had to understand. Oh, no. I had to talk and stop hiding.
That's right. That's right, because this is practice for you.
Right. So, Carter, then what is your best subject? What is it that you want to learn more about in school?
History and math.
Mm. All right. What about the other one?
I want to learn math and
one is
science.
Science.
Okay. All right.
Those two skills will take you around the world. Math and science will take you around the world. And this is what our young people don't understand about their education, how important it is, because it establishes something for you to do as an adult.
Yeah.
And if you don't take care of it now, by the time you're 20, you're going to have to play catch up. Mm-hmm. See, so that's why it's very important for what you're learning right now. And you're blessed to have a dad that wants to make sure you get the best that he could make available for you.
Oh, science, like, you can learn history, like, see how the Africans made those pyramids, mm-hmm. and you could go to the science books or something and get instructions, like, it tells you the words, and it tells you how to understand it. And it says, like with those toy things, you could, like, now you could build another pyramid because you could have a piece of paper where, like, step one and stuff, it says step one, but you have to get a big piece of paper.
I'm really motivated and encouraged that you, at some point, Cody, you're going to be putting stuff together as you grow up into a man. You'll be reading the instructions. But what I hope that you understand now is that they didn't have instructions when they built the pyramids.
They didn't.
It was pure. It was the conceptualization that Sister Heron is talking about, that they saw something. When Kawisi talked about, there is a person who's riding on a bus or in a car saying, I want to talk to somebody and I can't wait till I get home. So he thought to himself, what do I need to do to talk to that person? And I have to create a cellular phone. So those are the pioneers, the innovators, the people who invented something because their mind took them somewhere where that no one else had gone yet. Do you get that?
And let's be fair about the phone. It didn't start as a cell phone. It started as a portable phone that you could take with you. Instead of having that phone plugged into the one outlet in the house, now you can take it. They had car phones first. And when you see the first cell phone, it was the size of a shoebox.
Oh, it's bigger, like a suitcase.
Yeah. Carried a suitcase and they had the big shoebox up to their ear. Carrying the suitcase
it's
and
the
made
battery.
It work.
Right.
Yeah, the battery pack.
And the antenna and the radio. It was basically a radio.
Yes, that's what it was. It was a portable radio that you could hear your friends through.
When you said battery pack, that means, like, the battery would run out?
Yes.
Like, yeah, and how many battery packs would they give you?
Well, that's such an old phone. We don't have to worry about it anymore. It replaced the home phone. And it was a pioneer for what it is now.
Yeah, so the phone, like, you hang up on the wall, like, at school or something. Mm-hmm. Like,
he said at school.
At school, yeah. They don't have pay phones on the corners anymore.
Right,
so.
Not at home.
Yeah.
And, like, was it like the school one where just put their room or something? Like, their room and, like, their room number?
No.
Or their house number? You have to actually have a phone number.
Yeah, you had to have a phone number.
It was 10 digits.
It had a dial, just like your phone at home had a dial. And see, this is how the technology has changed. We went from dial to push button. They had the princess phone. All you had to do was push the buttons now instead of rotating the you wouldn't know what a rotary phone looks like.
Do you see how the technology, the information has changed?
Changed. Mm-hmm.
But the classroom is still the same.
Man.
Over 100 years, the classroom is still the exact same. You have, see, you got to listen with the intent to understand. Don't be so quick. The classroom is rows of chairs, got a big old board. Some technology is in the classroom now. You got a little bit more technology. People use more computers and the whole nine. But the concepts of a classroom has always been the same for hundreds of years.
Yes.
So when we're talking about stuff and they don't understand, it's because the classroom has not advanced with the technology. The classroom has not advanced with the understanding.
Right.
So while we're trying to explain to them and they're trying to put these pieces of the puzzle together, they don't understand. It's because they're looking at someone who's been in the same classroom as they have just maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago. That means that they have the same understanding as they do. It's just a little bit better. And they go right in the classroom and then teach them in a narrow corridor, narrow window to learn something that is vast as the whole entire earth.
Yes, yes.
So it's impossible to teach kids these days about life and understanding the vast, like the technology, the information in a classroom.
Right. Yes.
And the thing is what we was talking about in the beginning, what y'all was talking about in the beginning was as educating our youth is the fact that we have to sit there and understand in the climate of today and what we're trying to do and build in our communities. We have to not only get them out the classroom, but get them out of their classroom.
Yes.
We have to start creating our own schools. Now, Trump has decided to elect a lady that's in charge of our educational system who has no understanding on how to deal with the inner cities or any other
problem. She knows how to write a big check.
Now this is the key to this. Now, I don't get off subject, but this is the thing you have to think about. She wants to give the power of the money to the student so the student goes to whatever school they decide to go to. Now, this is the catch-22. There's less schools than students. For the quota of students, for the ratio of students is less schools. So if you have already you have a disadvantaged youth and disenfranchised youth in the inner cities with less schools to go to because they're low quality, you got to take those kids with the money who's going to go to a better school. It's going to overpopulate their school. Now, guess what? The best teachers are going to go to their school.
Yeah,
exactly.
But now the catch 22 on behind that is, there's still going to be kids left out.
That's right.
So now you still got to take the worst teachers and back into the same worst schools with less schools already available, and now you have a worse problem that you already had instead of investing in the infrastructure of the school system.
Well, you have the same thing here in L.A. For about 2 or 3 years straight, Crenshaw High School could put out a Marcus Johnson, a Big John Williams, and all the Strawberry Brothers that can hit a ball across the yard, and all these great ball players come from Crenshaw. But they lost accreditation for three years straight. Mm. So you mean to tell me that you can produce quality athletes, but you cannot produce a quality education? So I have a friend, Marcus Martin. He just graduated from USC in Crenshaw High, and he had a 3.7 grade point average. But do you know that 3.7 grade point average from Crenshaw High School means absolutely nothing to Yale, Harvard, or one of these Ivy League schools, not even Stanford?
Right.
Stanford would have took him because of his size, because of what he does on the football field, but not because of his education. Here, I got an athlete right here. Cody's going somewhere, and hopefully Carter, you know, finds his dream as well, whether it's basketball, music, or arts. But I don't want him to go to a Stanford or a USC based on the fact that he can run faster than everybody.
Right.
I need that education.
Right.
I need him to truly understand something, and he can't get it at Crenshaw or Dorsey. He's not going to get it from Manuel Locke because they're still at such a lower level. As you said, the quality of education that comes from these schools do not compare with Crossroads in Santa Monica.
Right.
Doesn't compare with some of these privately run schools that, as you say, have the money, have the best teachers, and can give a quality education to our children.
Let me ask it this way. By your definition of this woman that wants to give our kids the opportunity to pick schools they want to go to,
mm-hmm.
first of all, is that school going to take my child?
Exactly.
Okay. And the second thing, when you pull all of our kids out of these schools are going to be empty.
Exactly.
Okay. Then you have the transportation to send them somewhere where they're exactly. not welcome.
Right.
So what are we really gaining here? And we had that conversation last week because I sent our firstborn. I was determined to make sure that he got the same education that they were getting. So we sent him way out to Woodland Hills to El Camino, where his teacher called him a stupid nigger.
Yeah.
Okay. He spent 6 years out on the bus going to junior high school and then to high school mm-hmm. out there. And that was only to try to make sure he got the same education their kids got. Mm-hmm. And this is how he was treated. And so my frustration was they didn't want my chocolate son out there on their campus. They did not want him there. When I went out to confront them about the way he was being treated, nobody received me, not the principal. There was no, Mrs. Heron, come in, let's try to work this out. There was none of that. They sent me right to the instructor, and as I told Dr. Murray and Skip, his response was, well, if the shoe fits.
Well, see,
you see, so mm-hmm. Skip and I discussed the fact that I really wanted to punch him out. That was really my first instinct. That's right. really what I wanted to do, and we discussed the fact that I should have pulled my son out of that school. Should have pulled him out of that school. The problem is he was in the 11th grade,
mm-hmm.
almost out the door.
Yeah,
now,
the one thing
they did give him, mm-hmm. his education allowed him to go into Cal State Long Beach, allowed him to walk in instead of having to go to a junior college first and right. make his grades up, make up his classes. He was able to go straight into Cal State Long Beach. He really wanted to go to Southwest and play football.
Well, the one thing that I've actually been on the phone with a lot of African-American educators who's been in education for quite some time, and the key thing that we discussed was creating not only the schools, the small schools for our children, but also creating academies for educating the teachers.
Yes.
Yes. That's the key, because we can create our own atmosphere of for students, but if you don't have the right teachers and qualified teachers, not only right. to deal with the subject matter, but also dealing with the students itself.
Right.
Because now we're in a climate back in the day when my father was in a one room schoolhouse. That teacher went to your church.
Mm-hmm.
A teacher.
Lived
with
in your
parents.
Community.
They
right.
lived in your community.
Right.
So therefore, the home never left.
Right.
That teacher was your extended parent.
Right.
And
right.
then on top of that, when you had that one-room schoolhouse, the teacher had that eighth grader
mm-hmm.
that was teaching the sixth graders.
Right.
So the
right.
that eighth grader was relearning
yes.
all those basics and learning those basics all over again by teaching it. So then by the time she got into ninth or 10th grade, you couldn't tell her nothing.
Yeah. Right.
Well, hold on. Press pause. I need them to understand that.
Yes.
A one-room schoolhouse.
Okay. A one-room schoolhouse was a room about this size, possibly from all the way back here. Back in the days when people were segregated, which means that black people couldn't live with white people. We was in the South mainly, to where we was a lot of them was poor, just coming out of slavery or in slavery. So one-room schoolhouse meant that you had first, second, third, fourth, and fifth grade all the way up to eighth grade in one room, in the same classroom. So that means that you was in class with him, mm-hmm. and if I was in high school, I was in class with all of y'all.
Mm-hmm.
So the thing was the teacher couldn't teach everybody because it was only one teacher. It was one room, one teacher. So if you was in, what grade are you in?
Fourth.
What grade are you in?
Fifth.
So you was in fourth and you was in fifth. Guess who would have been your teacher? one of the students that's older than you would have been your teacher. They would have been teaching you because the teacher would be teaching them. So after I would have learned my lesson from my teacher, it would have been time for me to teach you what the teacher wanted you to learn, because they couldn't help everybody at all times. So what that done was, for me to be your teacher and learning from the actual teacher itself, as a student, I was a teacher and student, I was learning more because I was comprehending everything that I learned in fifth grade and in fourth grade. So I was constantly going over the basic information to where it was ingrained in me so I could understand it. So then you are always, so back in those times, when you look at the early 1900s, like that means 100 years ago. 100 years ago, we had higher educated African Americans than we do now.
Yes.
Because they didn't have No Child Left Behind. It was no, you either learn or you was going to get beat and fed.
That's it.
That was it.
Yeah. You had to
You learn. Had no choice.
And the truth is that tradition came about because we pushed education once it stopped being a crime for us to learn. And in that time, it's like, well, how do we survive in this world that's not ours if we don't know what that world is doing?
Exactly.
You see, so for survival reasons, we went to school.
How did you get there? Tell me how you got to school.
You
did
walk,
your mom drop you off?
You
did your mama drop you off?
Oh, no.
Did your mama come pick you
mom
up?
Mom didn't even have a wagon and a horse to drive me down the road.
Get to school. How y'all get to school?
We walk.
Now.
We walk.
Now y'all.
Now they walk.
They started walking about 4 or 5 months ago.
It was funny when I was
in
college.
Well, they're old enough to walk too.
Growing up, my father, he lived in the country. And the country means that your neighbor was probably a mile away.
Yes.
It wasn't a neighbor that you can see across the street. It was a mile away. And he used to talk about how he used to walk in the rain, sleet, and snow. He would walk. And the white students didn't have to walk. They had school buses. So the school bus would come by, they would throw stuff at them and do different things and be nasty. It'd be in the wintertime, it'd be snow, they had to walk in the snow. And it was interesting because you always heard the older people say, I had to walk 10 miles in really 4 or 3 or 2.
Yeah.
They would always exacerbate the distance and exaggerate everything. Yeah. But one summer, I took it upon myself. I said, you know what? I'm taking the summer classes. I literally live maybe I would say about 5 miles away from the school.
Mm.
I decided to walk every day
for
a summer, just to see. Now this is a place where it wasn't just a straight shot. It wasn't flat land.
Right.
So I had 3 major hills to walk. So no matter what time of the day, no matter what, I had to walk up. First, the hill was coming down. Both hills was down. The first one, and the second was a long steep hill, and I had to go through this valley and everything like that. Around the state capitol in Frankfort, Kentucky. So I walked every single day. Now in Kentucky, you got humidity and you got heat. Mm-hmm. So it was around between 90 and 100 degrees outside on the average. And then you had the humidity. It was always around 85 to 90 degrees humidity. So I learned.
That means you would have threw up, Carter.
Yeah.
So I learned.
Me too.
I learned that phrase. I had to walk to school every day. I had to understand just enough. And when I tell you, my calf muscles has never been so big in my life. I could sit down and they felt like I was flexing because I had to walk up those long, steep hills.
Yes, yes.
And it was interesting because I love all people of religions. So I would say, I had these, what's the ones that come by your door any time of the day? The Jehovah's Witnesses. It was interesting because I remember walking and there was a group of black ladies stopped me. And I recognized one of them because they worked at the school. And she literally stopped me and wanted to talk to me about the coming of God, of Jesus. And I have my shirt off. I'm sweating. I got my backpack on. I'm looking at her, and I said, "Ma'am, that message you about to tell me would sure sound good sitting in the car on the way to school." And they paused for a second, and they thought about, "Do you need a ride?" I said, "Why? Thank you. I surely do, because that day was hot."
Yes.
I was walking with no shirt on. I had my shirt. I had another shirt over my head. My backpack was just soaking wet from the back.
I was uncomfortable, but I had to learn. I had to tell myself, I said, I need to see how they had to live just on a regular basis every day.
But you know what? See, this is the difference in your generation and where you were raised and theirs. These are city kids. There's a bus stop. There's a dash. There's a ride. There's a bicycle. There's some way for them to get around.
So that's the reason why we have to bring it to them.
Right.
And we have to allow.
Why the history is important.
That's why the history is important. But the thing about the history is, like, something I was been talking about, Skip, was the fact that we have to bring the country. We have to bring the things that they don't understand. I got a question. Where do you get your milk from? Where do you get your milk from?
The store.
Where do you get your vegetables? If you want to get some fruit and vegetables, where do you get that from? Where does fruit and vegetables come from?
I don't know, but I get it from, I don't get it from the store. Eat
your mom
it.
Does.
But you get it.
Your
but
mom now, gets I the food
you
get, and
where do you
eat
get
it.
Your food from? If you get your vegetables and your fruit, where do you get it from?
Oh, the store.
The store.
And I was going to say about the learning, like, so they only had one teacher, and, like, they had to hurry up and teach the bigger kids.
Mm-hmm.
So the bigger kids
can teach the little kids.
And then we could separate the fourth graders and fifth graders and the kindergartners.
It wasn't necessarily separated. They all just sat in the separate roles. Yeah. It wasn't separated as far as a classroom. It was just using the same room all the time. So that's what it was. Now, the reason why did you think I asked you that? Because I asked you about where you get your food from, because in the South, it's a running joke for city kids. We always go to we always say, when they ask us where we get our milk from, we say a cow.
I just want to tell you that I had this conversation with this one. I'm picking him up somewhere, and he wanted an extra bowl of cereal. And I said, okay, I poured the cereal, so I need milk. So I get the milk. I said, well, where do you get milk from? And he said, the refrigerator. And I said, no, but if I want some more milk, where do I go get it from? Where does the milk come from?
Yeah.
And he says, the store. And I said, man, milk comes from a cow. He said, no, it doesn't. That come from the store. I'm with my mama. I go with her to buy it. Come from the store. He did not know that about 3-4 months ago.
I did.
So I told him, I said, listen, and this is where I got it from. It's pus and blood. It comes out pus and blood, and they separate it.
Too
and here's a guy. Here's a guy right here who knows it firsthand. Yeah. So when I said that to him, they're like, "Nah." And I actually got into an argument with their mother because she said, "It's okay. Don't tell him that. Let him drink the milk." And I'm thinking to myself, "I want him educated.
Mm-hmm.
I really want it." So this one knew that it came from a cow. That one said, "Man, it come from the store, and I know because I be with my mama when we go buy it."
He's 9 years old.
And that's the reason why. But see,
this is the time
that's
to
the reason
teach
why
the truth.
It's 110,000% important for us to not only try to educate our kids about math and science, but we need to educate our kids about agriculture in the cities. Because if you live in a city and something goes wrong, where your because transportation logistics is so important in the city.
Let me say something this way. Because your generation has no idea how to start a fire.
Oh,
I do. It ain't just them.
My generation, I would say this. The age group that's in the most critical position when it comes to self-sufficiency is pretty much 48 and under.
48 and younger, yeah.
Probably about 48 and younger.
Yeah.
Now, when you talk about the city, you're looking at close around 60.
Oh, yeah.
60 to 70. Because 60, when you get to 60 and 70 in the city, they had grandmothers and grandfathers who came from the South.
Right.
They grew up in that kind of understanding. They probably in the backyard, they had a garden.
Yes.
They understood a few things. They don't understand everything, but they understood a few things.
They understand growing tomatoes and growing your
own. Exactly. So when you talk about self-sustainability.
Well, these kids are the store generation.
These kids, now, see, this is the thing. That's the reason why it's important for me to do what I know. See, I had to think about it. I looked at Skip. I looked at the organizations that was going around here. They know the beat of the city and what's going on. Y'all understand the plight of African Americans in the city, being in the city.
Mm-hmm.
But my thing is, I didn't live in the city.
Right.
The city I lived in.
That's the advantage that you have.
That's the advantage. So I can bring what I know that's important for sustainability
to the city, and that's educating young people on food, on how to grow your own food, how to create those that environment so they can actually do it on their own.
Okay, because I'm not really arguing with you. I'm not disagreeing with you. I agree with that. But these kids are the store generation.
Store-bought kids.
Yeah, they store-bought.
Everything comes from the store.
I would say this.
What I'm looking for, I'm going to go find on the corner
in that store.
But
you know what's funny?
And so we're going to have to bring them out
of that. It's not hard. It's not hard.
Yeah, because
you have to just do it.
Right. Well, in the reality, like Skip's trying to teach them a bigger picture. Not everybody is doing that. They're satisfied.
That's the reason
to
why
let
it's
the
important.
School just teach them. Mm-hmm. They're satisfied for them just to accept the store.
So,
it's okay for them not to know how to build a fire.
But that's the reason why it's important for someone like myself or anyone that understands that's who they are.
Mm-hmm.
That's we have to retrain. We have to reteach because I promise you, if I get these two young men around food, growing produce,
vegetables,
mindset of where they get their food changes.
It will.
Because it will. Now they say, wow, I can do this.
It will.
So we're going to revisit that because we got a couple minutes. So I want to make sure that you tell me what stood out to you about this conversation we had. All the information that was just transpired right here.
What stood out to me is that I'm learning stuff in just an hour. I'm learning lots of things that I didn't know before.
Mm-hmm.
And what stood out to me is there's one thing that our teacher let us do is we have a garden in the school and she lets us plant things like collard greens and tomatoes.
Good.
And corn and I forgot another one.
That's great.
That's all right, but you're growing. Let me ask you this before we go. Have you ever had one of those tomatoes that you grew?
Did you ever eat one?
You ever eat one?
No.
Oh, okay.
That's the key. They have to consume what they make.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Cody? What stood out to you about this conversation this evening?
Well, at the first part, like history, I know that the like pyramids and stuff, like the Africans, the black people made the pyramid, and I learned that there was a pyramid. I thought like it was just on games and stuff, like games. And like I know that, well, I've been knew this how to grow stuff, but on like when we playing games or something, like on Minecraft or something, like planting stuff. On Minecraft, we just wait for the rain to come.
It's a video game.
That's a
video game.
100%.
Yeah. Right. And that's okay, but it's just a game. It's not real.
Doesn't it grow faster when the rain comes?
But it has to grow. Your brother is really getting a reality look at what that takes.
We want you
whereas
to grow
the
it.
Game fools you into thinking it should happen faster.
Right.
No, don't get that confused. That's fantasy versus reality.
Right.
And the most important thing your dad wants you to understand is the difference between the two. The difference between the two is very important for you to know what's real and what is not. And a game is never going to be real. It's just a game, okay?
And wrestling is not real either.
You talking about that pro wrestling or the WMMA or whatever they call it?
No, MMA is real.
Yeah, I know
that. MMA is real, and so is the, what is the other
UFC
one?
And boxing?
UFC is real.
Okay.
But the stuff they watch is...
Well, that's one thing I always encourage people to do with their children. Even though I grew up around just tons of kids growing up, is spend at least 2 hours doing something as a family together.
Yes.
Even if you don't know what you're doing as the adult.
Yes, yes.
Research it, doing a couple of times, some other time of the day. And you, as a family, do something at least 2 hours and let them learn something. And you can be learning in the process.
Yes.
Right. But you have to actually engage. You can't just watch a documentary and say, okay, we all learned something.
Got to engage.
You have to engage. You have to physically get them involved.
And lastly, they got to keep their head to the sky.
We're out of time already, huh?
Yeah. And I say this too. We have to stop telling our children. What is it called? We have to stop telling our children, hey, you can do anything you want to do, and then wait till they get to high school and say, hey, you need to focus.
Right.
Got to tell them to focus. You have to say,
okay, this is what we need. You have to groom them.
You're going to have to come back and finish right. that because we out of time. Right. And Maurice White is singing to us. God bless your community family. God bless these beautiful little children here. We just adore them. And I thank you so much for listening. And Gang Talk will be back next week.